I hope that you have a plan to vote. As a matter of fact, I hope that you found a way to vote already. All I know is that as a Christian, this isn't the time to disengage, and I'm going to show you that from scripture. Let's get into this week's recharge. So this week marked the beginning of two very important things here in America. The first is Latinx or Hispanic Heritage Month, Viva La Raza. And the second thing that started this week was early in-person absentee voting in several states across the nation. I think it's important for us to pause and acknowledge the importance of Bible-believing Christians getting out and voting. The truth is there are many people who are unsure whether or not they, as Christians, should even engage the political process at all. As a matter of fact, I was raised to believe that not only did my vote not matter, that somehow I, as a Christian, was not supposed to even participate in what was going on in our political system. Well, I believe that the Bible has something to say about that. The Bible gives us principles to help us to understand the importance as to why we should be engaged in this process, why it's important for us as Bible-believing Christians to get out and vote. Here's the first principle. God invites his followers to positively influence their environment. In Matthew 5, verses 13 through 16, Jesus says that Christians are supposed to be salt and light in this world. Listen to the words of Jesus. He says, "You are the salt of the earth. But if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot." I hope you know by now that there are Christians who have become absolutely saltless in America. Christians who are willing to pledge allegiance to policies and practices that are absolutely, unashamedly antithetical to the gospel of Jesus Christ. Listen, I'm no cook, but I can tell you when salt is missing from a dish. Salt, when used appropriately, has this powerful ability to bring out the very best in any culinary environment it finds itself in. And as I look out on the way that Christians have engaged the political process today, I see their presence, but I don't see them bringing the best out of their environment. And the explanation of scripture is that they must have lost their saltiness. God invites Christians to positively influence their environment. But don't just take my word for it. Ask Auntie Ellen White, Seventh-day Adventist, who says this in Gospel Workers, page 387. She says, "Every individual exerts an influence in society. In our favorite land of America, every voter has some voice in determining what laws shall control the nation." She says this, "Should not that influence and that vote be cast on the side of temperance and virtue?" Ellen White understands the powerful biblical principle that God asks, he invites, he even commands his children to positively impact their environment. But you have to remember this. Every time God invites us to make a positive impact, the enemy is working to stop us, to thwart us, to derail our attempts to make that positive impact. It's right here in the text. Jesus calls us salt and light. And yes, it's true that some Christians have lost their saltiness, but it's also true that the forces of darkness are trying to hide our light. Verses 14 and 15 say this, "You are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house." How do we take this text and apply it to our situation? Well, I believe that the forces of darkness are trying to choke out our light through the efforts of voter suppression and voter depression. You see, the enemy knows that if he can get Garrison to believe that his vote doesn't matter, matter. If he can get you to believe that your vote doesn't really count. If he can sow disinformation to make you think that these candidates are all the same. If he can plant the seed of bad theology, which would have you to conclude that God is ultimately in control of every single detail, so it doesn't matter what I do, instead of believing the truth of Scripture, which says that our loving God has given us the power to choose to make decisions, that our decisions are consequential. If he can plant that seed inside of you, then maybe you'll conclude that it doesn't matter whether or not I vote. And I believe that all of these are efforts to hide our light. You see, I believe that the reason why men like Medgar Evers were killed over advocating for voting rights was because the enemy desired to hide his light. Why women like Fannie Lou Hamer were assaulted over advocating for voting rights was because the enemy desired to hide their light. God invites us as his children to be salt and light in this world and to positively influence our environment. You see, my understanding about the satanic forces of voter suppression comes in part from our Adventist history. In 1859, Ellen White came to the conclusion that voting for and against a candidate was a moral imperative, especially when it came to certain issues like temperance. As a matter of fact, Ellen White tells the story about how these men came to her office one day and expressed their approval for how Adventists, how Sabbath keepers were refraining from voting. They were happy that Adventists, like other religious groups, chose not to exercise their right to vote. And Ellen White's interpretation about her encounter with these men who hoped to solidify that Adventists would not be voting in an upcoming election, her interpretation of this interaction is fascinating. She starts by saying, "Satan and his angels are busy at this time, and he has workers upon the earth." She draws a direct connection, a direct parallel between the work of these men who hoped to continue to suppress the vote of Sabbath keepers and the work of Satan. She is essentially saying here that the work of voter suppression to keep Seventh-day Adventists from exercising their influence over the political atmosphere, over the laws of this land, is the work of the enemy. And she concludes her story by saying this, "May Satan be disappointed is my prayer." In other words, her prayer is that Sabbath keepers, that believers, that Christians, that Adventists would get out there and vote. So right about now, you might be saying, "Okay, Pastor, I get it. You've made your point. God invites me to positively influence the environments that I find myself in. Ellen White invites Adventists specifically to engage with this process and Christians in general to impact democracy through our vote." But there's someone out there who's saying that people are selfish, they're self-interested, and they're just generally annoying, and you really can't trust the things that they say. So why should I even bother? Why should I take the time to try to influence this process if there's no guarantee that things will change for the better? I think that's a fair question. But the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ is that he will never ask us to do something that he has not already done for us. Jesus would never ask us to take the risk of trying to positively impact an environment, a place, a country, a planet. He would never ask us to do that without having already taken the time to do it for us first. You see, the reality is that me and you, we are generally annoying. We're self-interested. We're selfish. We're corrupt. And yet Jesus still thought it was necessary to risk it all, to get up from his throne and make his way to the ballot box called Earth, and to cast his vote on behalf of humanity. And yes, there are those who are corrupt. Yes, there are those who are self-interested. And in some corners of this earth, it won't even make a difference. And yet, he still went through with it. I'm so glad that we serve a God who is committed to positively influencing the environments, the places, the spaces, the people that he finds himself in. And he invites you and he invites me to do the same. Why don't you bow your heads with me for a word of prayer? Father God, I am so thankful for your commitment to our betterment. And God, you've seen fit to place us here in this country at this time, in this moment. God, you've seen fit for hundreds of years of suffrage movements, whether it be women's suffrage or the suffrage for black and brown people in this country. You've seen fit that we are now able to exercise this most precious privilege to influence, as Ellen White says, the laws of this land. God, I ask that we will take that on seriously, that we will really engage this process, that we'll honor this privilege. Thank you, God, for the way that you invite us to be consequential actors in your ultimate plan of salvation. God, my prayer is that Satan will be disappointed. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, that's all we have for you this week. Listen, if you're watching this on September 18th, then tomorrow, September 19th, is a huge day for the Community Praise Church. It's our International Day. I want you to get all the details that you need. So head on over to cpcsda.org/details. There you can get all the information about our Parade of Nations, about our drive up, and about just everything. It's a lot of details. That's why you're gonna go to cpcsda.org/details. That's the whole point. Go there. And while you're at it, click on over to cpcsda.org/give. There you can return your tithe and you can give a generous free will offering. It goes to support this ministry and all of the ministries here at the Community Praise Church. So thank you so much for giving. God bless you. Happy Sabbath. And we'll see you tomorrow at International Day.